Welcome back to Pax Unplugged. Jason Levine from the Dice Tower here with the other co-creator of Penny Arcade, Jerry Hulkins.
Yes.
How are you?
I'm fine.
This has been an amazing event that you guys are putting on.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you would know better than me, I think. You know, I mean, like, I have specific responsibilities that I have to iterate at a show like this. And, you know, most of my convention experience has been just between San Diego Comic-Con and PAX shows. You know, but there's a lot of the traditional board gaming shows. Like, there's people on the team that have been to them. But that hasn't really been in my experience. I mostly know about PAX and just and trying to make whatever this type of show is. So I don't even know. I can't really compare it to the other shows.
No, I mean, I could tell you this. From having, I go to everything. We go to Gen Con. We go to Essen.
You'd have
to. And really, what you guys have done here is, it's casual, but it's grand at the same time.
Dude, this is 1.0. I mean, this is the first. This is our first at bat for this thing. Like, we're not stopping at all. Like, we're already thinking about how to. We're already thinking about, you know, what 2018 looks like for this show.
So. Yeah, I mean, so there's definitely a 2018. For those of you who didn't know, there's going to be a 2018 for sure, which is awesome. So I know, obviously, you started out doing the video game, more video game conventions, and you're a big board gamer, so...
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm a gamer, right? And that's the main thing, is that, you know, for me, that bright line just never existed for me. Like, I like systems. Like, my favorite thing is to learn a new system. And so a show like PAX is a real treat because that's mostly what I'm getting to do. I don't have a lot of chance to iterate strategies. I don't have a lot of chance to, like, go deep on a single game. Basically, I spend the weekend just, like, learning these different ways of thinking.
Yeah.
Oh, it's just, it's, I don't know. For me, at least, that's what it's about. Like, I like the social interactions and all that kind of stuff. Like, I mean, all the things that are good about gaming in general are good about that type of game as well.
Yes.
But for me, just all those different moments of individual, just like mastering these individual concepts is a real treat.
Yeah, I mean, we've been talking about that this is really a play convention, and everyone who's coming out here, there's a lot of playing going on.
Is that not normal?
Not at the big ones. I mean, at Gen Con there is, yeah. But at Essen,
it's just a store, right?
It's only a store.
Yeah, I've heard that. So I've never had a chance to go. So,
but yours is kind of both, but you've made the play part. It seems even more important. Not that the store part's not important, but it's very interesting that the play seems to be the big thing here, which is great.
Well, yeah. I mean, the reality, right? It's in some ways, you know, my job is pretty weird in that, you know, if there's something that I want to investigate, you know, my time is spoken for the most part. But if there's something I want to do, I basically need to sort of materialize, like build a business case around it. And I really, really want to meet people and buy new board games and check them out with my friends. And so I sort of had to make a convention in order to make that happen. Because it's real hard for me to get out to something like Essen. And, like, that's a bucket list thing for me. But that's all pretty close to PAX Oz. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
A lot of my time is spoken for. I have to invent something like this. Obviously, the team is the one that executes it. But we have to come up with, you know, a situation that's functional and reproducible. So that we can do it. And hopefully that comes across. Like, hopefully it feels like a show that someone really cared about and wanted to invite other people to.
It does. I mean, I haven't been to any of the regular PAX shows.
Oh, yeah, because it's not your thing. But see, this is the thing, is that this is what you don't know, is that, you know, something like this occurs at PAX shows, too. Every PAX show has a substantial portion of it. And before this, it was PAX South that had a real tabletop focus. But every PAX show has something like this, almost on this scale, that exists inside the video game convention. You might not have known that.
No, I mean, I know Tom went out and he said he went to PAX East in Boston.
Yeah,
and
he went to East.
Yeah, and he said that there was a gaming crowd, but to have an actual one that's all about board gaming was cool.
I think that's valuable independently. You should definitely come to East just to see what the tabletop scene is like there. But I've had a lot of people here. But PAX has got a lot of different stuff. Like, it is basically, you know, it's hard to say that it's a single convention. There's, you know, panel tracks and massive exhibition floor, main theater, experiences. Like, there's a lot. And then in the case of the Seattle show, it really extends out into the town itself in a lot of ways. There's, you know, there's a bunch of different independent venues that are all a part of the PAX show. But what I've heard from people at this show is that because it has a tabletop focus, like, they always want to do that stuff at the other shows, but they're pulled in all these different directions. Here, you're basically granted license. Like, that's what you should be doing here. And I think that it's just, I think that it's relaxing in a way that one of the larger shows can't be, because it is manifesting an event that appeals to a lot of different interests.
Yeah, it's funny that you call this a small show. There's 20-something thousand people, and you're calling it a small show.
Well, some of the other shows are very big, right? But you know, that scale, and this show is going to grow too, but that scale at some of the other shows, like I say, it sort of like warps your plan. There's always, like in all these venues, there's going to be some place that you want to go, something that you want to see. Here, we're inviting the attendee to play.
Yes.
Like, that's the main thing.
Yes, but you also have the panels and everything. I mean,
yeah.
There's a lot of them here.
Oh, sure,
and there's
sure.
things for
that's
everyone.
That's a PAX thing. Absolutely, right? So if you want that. And then there's also, I think, some really innovative panels that, you know, that so Unplugged, another thing that Unplugged can be for us is a way to experiment, because the other shows function, and it's like something's working, you don't want to, you know, mess with it too much. But one of the things that this lets us do is experiment with new formats. And a couple of the formats that we're really excited about is the First Look section out in the main area, which is basically like a bunch of like Ryan Hartman and our tabletop enforcer team. We chose a bunch of the new stuff from Essen. And this is a great chance to come and check that stuff out. It's all fresh.
Yes.
Right? Learn it with new people. Right? And then we also have our Learn and Play, the Learn and Play rooms, where you can basically get taught games, a couple games. You can learn games with a bunch of other people. I mean, it's almost like speed dating for games. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, so these are a couple really novel things that I'd be surprised if they didn't materialize in some form at the other shows.
They've both been great. I mean, you have all the hottest games from Essen here. Like, everything that was hot at Essen is here.
Good stuff. What's the circuit? Meeple Circus?
Meeple Circus.
What's that? I mean, everybody's telling me about this game.
You need to play this.
What's the hook?
So the hook is you have all these little meeples, and they're different ones, and you're kind of drafting them. So you have some regular meeples, and you have some platforms, and you have horses, and then you have to like stack them and build like a little, like as though they're doing a show while the music's playing, and you have to be the quickest to build your show.
How do you start the music?
There's an app that comes with it.
Oh, okay, so you install it and hit the button?
You hit the button, the music starts playing, you hear do-do-do-do-do, all this circus music.
Do-do-do-do-do-do.
Exactly.
Okay, nice.
And they have all sorts of things like, if you have a red meeple standing on a horse, you get 2 points, and there's all these rules, so you're trying to build up your thing.
So does every individual player have their own little like menu of like the configurations that are the most valuable?
Yes.
Oh.
So you have some individuals, and then there's goals that everyone can do, so there's goals that everyone does.
No!
Yes. Well, we'll play it. We have to play this one.
Dude, that sounds kick.
It is. It totally
That's live.
Is.
And when we're done, I'm going to go in there and take a look at this, because I bet there's some circuses going on right now.
There probably is. We'll go over there. We'll get you coverage of Meeple Circus. Don't worry. You guys know how much we love the game.
Dude, that sounds like a treat.
It is. It's fun. It's a blast. Have you played any of the games?
Yeah, I played a couple. Have you ever... Are you familiar with Hero Realms?
Yeah.
I love Hero Realms. Did you see they have the expansions here now?
Yes, yes.
The campaign one, but they also have those two boss decks.
Yes.
Like that... That's a big deal to me. Have you ever played the 2v2 in Hero Realms?
No.
Do it. Like, 1v1 is amazing. Like, I love that. Especially if you add the character-specific decks. That's a treat. The campaign is neat because it seems like there's a reward track. As you're succeeding, you get new cards for your starter deck. That's amazing. I definitely want that. The 2v2 mode is one of the most cooperative games I have ever played in that space. Because, you know, basically, you know how it is. It's a deck builder thing.
Yes.
We're going to lay out our money. We're going to lay out our attack, right? But that becomes a pool that you and I as teammates
share. Oh, wow.
And then get this. Like, I never would have considered this twist at the end. When we buy from the auction, our turn is simultaneous. When we buy from the auction, then there's a decision point. Whose deck does it go in?
Oh.
Are we trying to create decks that are... Because we're drawing all the decks... And then we're laying them out together. We actually want to have the hybrid that strength
yes.
that comes from these things being distributed through this meta deck. Oh, man, it is worth it. You got to try it.
It sounds like it. I mean, Dice Masters has that 2v2 option now, too, and it sounds very similar, which I love the 2v2 options like that, where you, do I want this card? Is it better in your deck? Is it better in my deck? Oh, that's great.
No, there's flavor. There's just sick flavor. I played another game called The Builders. Have you seen that?
Yes.
That's kind of smooth.
Yes.
I had a really good time with that. I was able to, you know how it is, like, if you win your first game of something, you're like, this is a great game. But I think that it's actually very, very clever. How you do the block stacking and you're continuously climbing. Like, it's a very
yes.
fun, interactive game.
And do you put the small ladder or the medium ladder and you want to get to the
single
top?
Single use. And then the that little pip that you have that keeps people from touching a block. Delish.
Yes, the blocking. I mean, that's what makes the game is you want to block people
especially
out.
Especially when you're up there high and it's just you and somebody else. It's just like, no, you can't come up here. You get to languish down there. That's your job.
Yes, linguish down there. We're never letting you up.
No. I'm up on top. I would. No, it's good stuff, man. But like I say, there's, you know, I've only been through about half of it back there. And, you know, I played a few of the games that I wanted to check out. There's some, you know, real lo-fi stuff going on over in Unpub. Like, you get a chance to play
yes.
games that are really, really young. I don't know, man. I'm having a super good time. I think it's a really, really great first year.
I think so too. I mean, what's interesting is I know you're not getting a lot to play, but I've noticed that you guys work really hard here. I mean, at Dice TerrorCon,
we try to move, yeah.
Like at Dice TerrorCon, we try to always be out there for mm-hmm. all of our fans, mm-hmm. and you do the same thing. You're out here for your fans. You're doing the comic strip live. You're out doing the Penny Arcade. You're doing all these things, and you really make yourselves accessible, which is great.
Well, and it's tough, right? I mean, it's a thing where, you know, I'm kind of a nerd. Like, I have, you know, I've got some pretty substantial social anxiety, right? But this is a place where that's true for a lot of people, and there's just a really nice middle space that we can all sort of get together, meet each other, learn some new skills together. Like, it's a very, very good convention for me, right? It's a very, very good convention for me and people like me, which I think is a lot of people who you grew up a certain way.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean? Like, we sort of had to, like, build and, like, construct our families out of people with shared interests.
Exactly.
I think that this is a pretty good place to do that.
And that's why I think, like, gaming in general, the mm-hmm. whole thing about community and you can sit down and, you know, you can become social by through the game, but also just interacting with the people.
It's very, very human. It's just a very, very human mode, I think.
No, it's great. I mean, you guys have done an amazing, I have to say
Thank
this,
you.
Amazing
Thank
job
you.
At this. And we're really looking forward to coming next year and seeing what more there is.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we're trying to figure out all the ways to level up the different sections of the show. We already have lots of ideas. Like, there's been a lot of substantial learnings, even just from the first year. But we're taking all that stuff on board. We're going to try to figure out how to improve it.
Yes. No. Well, you heard that here. Next year, there's going to be one. PAX Unplugged 2 at 2018, the sequel. And thank you so much for
pleasure,
coming
man.
On the show.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Jerry Holkins, one of the founders of Penny Arcade, founders of PAX, founders of all of this, and putting on an amazing show once again. Jason Levine from the Dice Tower, here from PAX Unplugged.